Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Mustangers by Andrew J. Fenady, narrated by Lewis Arlt. Prelude, Out of the Past. The land changes. Sometimes it takes years. It takes centuries. Hundreds, sometimes thousands of centuries, during the journey of ages immemorial. At other times, the land shudders, cracks, and abrupt peaks protrude to pierce the skin of soil and steeple over the still restless earth. And with the infinite turning of the earth, vast oceans waste and dry into sand and desert. The sea, sporadically dotted with islands, at times is calm, a liquid horizon. But the sea at other times is fierce, with scolding winds, upturned trees, and stark destruction, leaving naked islands sinking to a watery tomb of an exhausted deep. But the sky is eternal, ever-changing, yet ever the same. Sun and clouds and mist, even through thunder, lightning, and rain. Then, after the curtain of night falls and rises, the sky is ever the same. Sun and clouds and mist. Where 100 years ago, in the mid-1870s, through the same western sky, only eagles flew, on this day, a lone jet streaks between towering spires to fulfill a promise made when the West was old, but younger. Chapter 1. Flying over the rugged crests of the western countryside, the silver Gulf Stream jet streamed through protruding peaks. Patrick Merrill walked out of the pilot's cabin and closed the door, then paused. There were those who said he had a striking resemblance to the actor Tony Curtis. Merrill didn't mind at all. In fact, he agreed. He smiled and looked down at the leggy, blue-eyed, freckled, blonde attendant sitting in a front chair, reading Life magazine. The small metal plate pinned to her tunic identified her as Trudy Ryan. Merrill pointed back to the pilot's cabin. "Just check the compass. You can relax, True. We're right on course." She glanced up, semi-smiled, and went back to life. Unfazed, Patrick Merrill continued to smile. He smiled a lot, like he was kidding the whole world, including himself. But not his boss, Senator Jimmy Deegan. Senator Jimmy Deegan sat at a small desk making notes on a yellow legal pad, with a slim, open briefcase on the desk. Near the briefcase, a framed photograph of a handsome red-headed woman and two young sons. In his mid-40s, Senator Deegan, shirt-sleeved, with a rugged face, muscled build, and a few needles of gray at the temples, looked up at his approaching assistant. "Senator, the pilot says that we just crossed the state line. Your state, Senator. Be landing within the hour." "Thanks, Patrick." "Can I have the attendant get you some coffee?" "No, thanks." He nodded toward the photograph. "Mary Frances says I drink too much coffee." "I know I do. I'll pass, too." Merrill turned and started to walk toward the attendant. "But I do have the time and inclination for an overdue Monte Cristo. Why don't you sit down, Patrick?" "Don't want to interrupt you, Senator." "All done, my boy. Take a seat." An unlit cigar rested in an unused ashtray. Senator Deegan lit the Monte Cristo, placed the legal pad into the briefcase, then lifted and looked at the photograph. "You know, Patrick, next month will be our 10th anniversary."
"Congratulations, Senator. Too bad she couldn't come along."
"With two young ones and expecting a third, Dr. Davies prescribed no flying. We're hoping for a girl this time. Even got a name picked out. Shannon. Mary Frances is Irish, you know."
"You're a lucky man, sir. It isn't easy to find a girl like her."
"You bet.
Me? I'm waiting for a girl like that to find me. In the meanwhile..."
Merrill looked up front toward the attendant. Senator Deegan chuckled, puffed on the Monte Cristo.
put the photograph into the briefcase and looked down out the window. "You were born around here, weren't you, Senator?" "No, no. Born in the East. But I used to spend the summers here on my father's ranch, the Big Brawny. In those days, it was on the rim of the Dust Bowl."
"Dust Bowl?"
"Yep. And you, Patrick, where were you born?"
"In the East," he smiled. "The Far East. New Jersey. Passaic. But seems I heard about the Dust Bowl. Saw a movie about it once on television. Can't remember the name."
"The Grapes of Wrath."
"Yeah. All that happened a long time ago, didn't it?"
"Well," the senator shook his head and smiled, "it wasn't all that long ago. At least it doesn't seem like it. During the 30s. Still, I guess that things have changed a lot since then." "In a movie, John Wayne once said, things usually change for the better." "I'd like to think he was right." The senator looked out of the window again. The plane was flying lower now. He pointed below. Patrick Merrill leaned and looked down. A herd of horses galloping across the terrain. The speeding shadow of the jet approached, crossed, and passed by the herd, running wild and free.
"Horses," Merrill smiled. "I guess they'll always be horses."
"Those aren't horses. Not just horses."
"They're not?"
"No. You city fellas can't be blamed for not knowing the difference, but those are mustangs. And in a way, that's why I'm making this trip."
"I don't understand."
"No reason why you should, unless I tell you."
The senator looked at his wristwatch.
"We've got some time yet. You want to hear?"
"You bet. Yes, sir."
"Well, then, light up one of your coffin spikes and I'll bend your ear."
Patrick Merrill reached inside his suit coat jacket, pulled out a half-empty or half-full pack of Pall Mall cigarettes, lit one, and leaned back to listen.
"It started when I met a cowboy named Ben Smith."
The senator thought a moment, then proceeded.
"No, I guess it started before." He took a draw from the Monte Cristo. "I'll tell it like a story I might write about him someday, when I'm through with politics, and vice versa."
A rodeo arena in Globe, Arizona. Band music, the stands overflowing with spectators, men, women, and children. Flags, balloons, streamers. Rodeo clowns performing in the arena, prelude to the next event. Beer flowed and was swallowed from the bottle, the can, and paper cup. There were hip flasks left over from Prohibition and the early 30s, when hard cash was rare in the cities, states, and country. But there was prize money to be won during the Depression of the mid-30s. Ben Smith had ridden thousands of broncos at hundreds of rodeos. He was no stranger to Globe, where he broke some of Tom Horn's records that people said would last hundreds of years. But this time it was different. There's an old saying, there never was a horse that couldn't be rode. There never was a cowboy that couldn't be throwed. Ben Smith made his way toward the chutes. Three of the most interested spectators stood watching while he walked closer to one of the gates. Two friends, one the opposite. The friends, Quirt Dawson and Stretch Monahan. Quirt, lanky, nearly 6.5 feet tall, almost a couple of decades past his rodeoing days, with a broken beak that had been struck by fists and the ground, and even in these lean days, there were scattered few ranchers, racehorse owners, and speculators in this area who didn't pay for Quirt Dawson's appraisal before shelling out hard cash for horse flesh. Stretch Monahan, former jockey, and a good one, until he started spending prize money on booze, broads, and betting on the bangtails. He got the nickname years ago when he enlisted in the Fighting 69th during the war to end all wars. The recruiting sergeant asked, "Weight?"
120, more or less.
"Height?"
5'2" when I stretch.
From then on, Danny became Stretch Monahan. Now, instead of riding racehorses, Stretch Monahan groomed and timed them. Spud Tatum, the third interested party,
was a young cowboy contestant full of himself, and himself only. He could sit a bronc well enough, but the size of his Stetson kept swelling in order to keep up with his hubris. The announcer's voice gusted through the speakers.
Ladies and gentlemen, and cowboys and cowgirls, the next rider is number 13, Ben Smith, riding that dreaded terror of the circuit, Basher.
Ben Smith was in the chute and saddled. Tall, lean, broad of shoulders, with a creased face, clear, narrow blue eyes, and a chiseled chin line, leaning forward on Basher. The announcer's voice heightened dramatically.
You all know Ben is a three-time all-round champion cowboy, a living legend of the rodeo circuit.
More like ancient history, Spud snorted. Old Bones was lucky to step up on that horse. And you, Flannel Mouth, Stretch looked up at him, are a horse's ass.
Yeah, button up, Tinhorn. Quirt looked down at him. You couldn't carry Ben's spurs.
Spud Tatum grinned. We'll just see who carries home the prize money. The announcer was now at full steam on the public address system.
Ben Smith in the saddle, now ready to ride on Basher.
Ben Smith nodded toward the gateman. Outside, Ben declared. The gate swung open. The animal leaped into the arena as the crowd roared. Hooves springing into the air, pounding forward, scraping against the fence, snorting, sunfishing. All in less than 5 seconds, Ben was thrown off. Ben's head crashed hard, too hard, through the fence rail. Spectators stood. Some screamed. Some turned away. Then, stunned silence. Rodeo clowns and other cowboys rushed to the aid of the unconscious man. There never was a cowboy that couldn't be throwed. Chapter 2. In the first aid room, Ben was conscious, barely, and still disoriented, as they all come into focus. Dr. Blake Lewis, a big man with a gentle touch and a bedside smile, who had been through it all too many times, for better or worse. Deke Evans, the rodeo owner, friend and foster father to Ben, since Ben won his first contest at his first ride at this same arena in the early post-war years. And, of course, Quirt Dawson and Stretch Monahan. Ben looked around and did his best to raise his bandaged head from the bed. It was not easy. Dr. Lewis placed his hand on his patient's shoulder. How you doing, Ben? His patient managed to smile.
You tell me, Doc.
You were sent for, but you didn't go. You're all together. But that fence isn't.
That hammerhead, Ben coughed, lived up to his name. You gave him a ride, son, Deke Evans said.
Yeah, Ben replied. A short one. Night at the Appaloosa Saloon. The bar was populated with men and women in Western attire at the counter and at tables, drinking, playing cards, pinball machines. Smoke crawled upward toward the tin ceiling to the tune of Western music from the blinking jukebox near one of the circulating fans suspended from above. Some of the jukebox lyrics were audible. Some were lost due to the cacophony of conversation, laughter, and alcoholic intake of the customers. At a table not far from the entrance, Ben, Deke Evans, Quirt Dawson, and Stretch Monahan were drinking beer. Ben's head was still bandaged, but it didn't prevent him from wearing his Stetson. Irene Swindersky, one of the waitresses, strawberry blonde, hazel-eyed, a wee mite thick but fetching, dressed in jeans cut off above the knees, pink boots, and tight-fitting denim shirt, was weaving her way around tables and customers. Not coincidentally, the lyric refrain from the jukebox accompanied her tour.
Good night, Irene, good night.
Hey, Irene! One of the customers stood up from a table and shouted, they're playing our song!
Not our song, bub, my song, Irene Swindersky shot back and kept on traveling toward her destination.
How's the beer supply, boys?
Quirt lifted a near-empty mug.
Close to desperate, Miss Irene.
Well,
That's my department. I can do something about that. She pointed to Ben's bandaged head.
Would you want me to toss a couple of aspirin in that beer, cowboy?
Shot of bourbon might be better, Stretch suggested.
No, thanks, Ben smiled. Just a straight mug of Lucky Lager, if you please.
I try to. Irene Swindersky nodded and walked away.
Some try. She succeeds, Stretch snorted. Or so I'm told. There was applause from the area near the entrance as Spud Tatum strode in, one hand full of money and the other arm wrapped around the upper body of a voluptuous Valkyrie who could start or stop a human stampede. Spud Tatum nodded and smiled at the hand clappers, then smiled even broader as he approached, then paused at the table where Ben Smith and his friend sat.
"Evening, gents," then at the rodeo owner. "Mr. Deke Evans, you run the best rodeo west of the 100th Meridian. Yeah, bo! Most prize money I won this year, or any year."
Then waved the money toward Quirt.
"I told you, didn't I, Quirt, old dirt?"
Quirt, old dirt, didn't respond, and Spud continued and squeezed the Valkyrie's bare shoulder.
"Hey, you fellas all know Wanda here?"
All the fellas nodded. Wanda nodded back.
"Sure, I know the fellas."
Spud grinned toward Ben Smith.
"How you doing, old-timer?"
"Still ticking."
The winner winked at his companion, said,
"Yeah," more than a little too loud,
"but winding down, I'd say,"
and laughed. Quirt rose in a quick, aggressive move, but Ben took hold of Quirt's arm for just a beat. Spud stopped laughing and turned toward Wanda.
"Come on, you sweet bag of sugar. We got some celebrating to do."
He commenced to guide her across the room. The way she walked was an anatomical marvel.
"She knows what she's got, all right," Stretch noted, "and how to use it."
"I knew a filly like that in Wichita," Quirt rubbed his chin. "Sexy, but not romantic."
Spud Tatum's voice roared at the bartender.
"Drinks for the house on the big winner."
At Ben's table, Deke Evans shook his head in disgust.
"Stupid loudmouth."
"Diarrhea of the jawbone," Stretch added.
"He's young," Ben smiled.
"He won't always be young," Quirt said, "but he'll always be stupid. That's something he'll never outgrow." And finished his beer.
Irene Swindersky approached with a tray loaded with mugs of beer.
"Here you be, gents. You heard what the Bronx Squeezer said. This round's on him. Drink up anyhow."
After the mugs were distributed, Deke Evans lifted his and nodded.
"Well, Ben, good health and good fortune." They drank.
"Yep," Ben said. "And speaking of health, Deke, I thank you for everything, but I'm hanging him up through rodeoing."
"Say it isn't so, Ben," from Quirt.
"Pay no attention to that two-bit tin horn," from Stretch.
"You sure, Ben?" from Deke Evans. "Won my first prize money from you, Deke, but I've been through for some time. Gonna quit while I'm still in one piece and can look back with a little pride."
"Ben, some of your records will never be broke," from Quirt.
"But some of my bones will be."
"Ben," Evans countered, "just 'cause you're not gonna ride, well, your name's still a draw, a big draw. I can give you a job, a good job. Be pleased to. You've earned it."
"Thanks, but I don't want you to give me anything. Going home."
"Home," Quirt said. "For some of us, home is just another word for saddle."
"Not for me. Not anymore."
"Where then?"
from Stretch.
"The Little Brawny. Fair-sized ranch. Just enough land. Just enough challenge."
"And family, Ben?" Deke Evans asked.
"No."
"Well, you got more friends than there are fiddlers in hell," Deke Evans smiled. "Need a steak, Ben?"
Ben Smith shook his head and took a swallow of beer.
"Thanks. No, Deke. I'm fine."
As Tatum and Wanda approached, it was hard to determine which of the two was laughing louder.
"Whoa, Nelly!"
Tatum pulled Wanda to an abrupt stop at Ben's table.
"I want a bit adios to these here hoodowls."
He made a mock bow to the table.
Well, good seeing you, old cabin robbers. But Wanda and me got to make a couple more stops, he glanced at smiling Wanda, before we turn in and mate.
Silence from the cabin robbers. A well-seasoned, white-bearded Westerner hesitatingly approached the table, looking at Ben Smith. The stranger carried a slim autograph book and fountain pen.
Excuse me all, but Mr. Smith, sir, they told me you were in here. Missed you at a couple of other rodeos. Come all the way from Casper, Wyoming, to add your autograph to my collection before it's too late. For me, not for you. Would you do me the honor, sir?
Ben nodded.
My honor, Mr. Bailey. Austin Bailey.
Ben took the book and wrote across a page while the others watched. Then he handed the pen and the still open book to Austin Bailey.
There you are, Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey's hand shook slightly as he gazed at the page, then at Ben.
Thank you, Mr. Smith, and thanks for the sentiment that you wrote. I surely appreciate.
Spud Tatum cleared his throat and smiled.
I suppose you want my autograph. I'm Spud Tatum, you know.
Yes, I know, Bailey nodded, but I only collect signatures from all-round champion cowboys. Thanks again, Mr. Smith.
He turned and slowly walked toward the entrance.
Strange old coot, Tatum shrugged, then turned to Wanda. Well, come on, sweet bag of sugar. Time's a-wastin'.
Then one parting look at Ben Smith.
By the way, old Ben, I just put another nickel in the jukebox for a song that'll be coming on about now, dedicated to you.
As Spud and Wanda made their way toward the door, Tatum looked back and smiled. Young Gene Autry's voice swelled through the jukebox.
Get along, little doggie, get along, get along. I'm heading for the last roundup.
Chapter 3. The wonder of it all. Ben Smith was on a journey of a little less than 1,000 miles and a lifetime of a little more than 40 years. After a quarter of a century, weary, bone-bruised, now without the bandage but wearing his Stetson, the 3-time all-round champion cowboy, instead of on a horse, sat behind a steering wheel. He had slipped into his already loaded pickup in Globe before first light at 4 a.m., so as to avoid good-intentioned friends and strangers with a volley of farewells and amen till we meet agains, as if he ever would with most of them again. Times change. People change. And when you're traveling, the land changes, especially in the West. And Ben had time to think while he found out all over again what a big country this is. And no two places are exactly alike. The wonder of it all. How they survived their journeys just over 100 years ago, those who survived, on horseback, on mules, on wagon trains, on foot. This same terrain that Ben was crossing from south to north, but 100 years ago the varied voyages were compassing east to west. Westward from the Mississippi, across the open plains, where buffalo had ranged and were commissary for Indians, then slaughtered by invaders, by the army, railroaders, hunters, sportsmen, for the delicacy of tongue, the fashion of robe, the ornament of horn on walls of Easterners who had never seen a live buffalo. Until the Indian commissary was empty, as were the Indian bellies. Through the white-hot heat of scorched desert sands, the winter frost and blinding snow of sky sierras, the deep and cavernous canyons, across raging rivers and bleak horizons. With desperate hope ahead, and wooden crosses on lonely mounds to mark, for more than a few, journey's end. And for the descendants of some of those pilgrims who were making another journey even now, Okies, moving west toward California, on rattling Fords, creaking Chevy pickups, on bicycles, and on foot, leaving behind them abandoned skeletal houses leaning windward, along with thin needling dust that had savaged once fertile land, leaving behind the dust bowl. Ben Smith crisscrossed some of these vagrant caravans, crawling west, while he drove north through that devastated dust bowl. During the so-called Great War, he had seen and been a bloody part of men in opposing trenches doing their damnedest to destroy one another. But they had weapons, guns and grenades and cannon, and a cause to end all wars. But these were men, women, and children, babies, ragged and half-starved with no weapons except the will to move on and to survive. If Ben had ever felt sorry for himself, now, at the sight of these poor, oppressed migrants, he realized how sorrow was spelled. He had suffered his share of lumps, but unlike those vagrants, he had some idea of what was ahead. The Little Brawny, fair-sized ranch, just enough land, just enough challenge. One door closes, another door opens. Even though he didn't know the extent of the challenge part, compared to those Okies, he was one damn lucky cowboy. That's right, he told himself. One damn lucky cowboy driving in the comparative comfort of a 1934 Chevy pickup, equipped even with a radio that had been accompanying him with dozens and dozens of country western songs. Words and music that all seemed to blend together until he crossed his state's border. Then there came a song with words and music he had never heard before, titled, "You Can't Ever Go Home Again." A man'll come home to the place of his youth in search of the things left behind. He looks for a place, for a smile on a face, but the last mile's the hardest to find. I've known the high country where lone eagles fly, the desolate no-path terrain. And now that my years are all winters, I try to call back the summers in vain. So don't you know, my friend, know the hollow cry of the lonesome man. You can't ever go home again, again. You can't ever go home again. Ben turned off the radio. After listening to that, he didn't want to hear any more songs for a while, and he thought to himself. Two of the most unpredictable, uncertain times in your life are when you leave home and when you come back.
Chapter 4. The terrain was different now, gentler, greener, and more hospitable. The front of Ben's pickup was different, too, and less hospitable. Steam from the radiator curled above the fore of the hood, and vaporous clouds drifted toward the windshield. The good news was evidence of civilization. Still steaming, the pickup pulled into a gas station at a crossroad, Randy's Independent Gas.
"Great thunder and hallelujah!" Randy shouted as he approached and almost instantly recognized his customer.
Randy, a born Westerner, tall, bow-legged, and booted. He wore a Stetson-style hat, except it was fashioned out of straw and made him look more like Huckleberry Finn than Billy the Kid. His smile broadened into a gaping grin.
"You're Ben Smith himself, ain't you?"
"Have our trails crossed, partner?"
"No, sir."
Randy shook his head and tilted the brim of his straw Stetson.
"But I seen your pictures, read all about you."
The young man with the crooked smile gushed.
"I'm Randy Rawlins, at your service, sir."
"Well, Mr. Rawlins," Ben pointed to the hood, "can you do anything about that?"
"Can I? Watch this."
"I'll do more than that, Randy. I'll give you a hand."
"Not on your tintype, sir. This is my specialty. Happens all the time."
A few minutes later, with the hood lifted and steam still spouting, Ben stood watching while Randy held the radiator cap in one gloved hand, poured a stream of water from a hose into the radiator with the other.
"That's the sunny side of owning this business. You never know who's liable to show up. I wouldn't be surprised to see Shirley Temple drive in someday, or—"
Randy was still smiling.
"Boris Karloff."
Well, it's good to see that a young fellow like you actually owns a business like this. Ben pointed to the sign, Randy's Independent Gas.
Well, I'm actually buying it from my daddy. Old sign used to say Randolph's Independent Gas. Might take the rest of my life, or his'n, to pay daddy off. Just a short while and you'll be on your way.
Appreciate it.
Nothing's too good for the best cowboy ever come out of these parts, Mr. Smith.
Ben.
You back to visit or stay, Mr. Ben?
Stay.
Wahoo!
Yeah, wahoo. Might as well fill her up when you're done, son.
You bet. Well, looky here, Mr. Lofty Lofty himself.
A custom-designed Chrysler Woody station wagon drove in and braked next to one of the two pumps. Mounted on the hood of the wagon, a pair of long horns. The driver and passenger stepped out. James Deegan, in his 40s, dressed in custom-made boots, tailored pants, and western shirt. Near him, his son, Jimmy, 8, taller and thinner than most his age.
Be right with you, Mr. Deegan, soon as I...
Go ahead and take care of him, Ben said. I'm in no hurry.
Yes, sir.
The young boy proceeded toward a drinking fountain as his father popped the Chrysler hood and moved toward Randy, who was filling the tank. Ben removed a lariat from his pickup and was idling with it as the boy finished at the fountain, then noticed Ben with the lasso. The next minute, the youngster began to tentatively approach, eyes on the lariat.
Hi, my name's Jimmy Deegan.
Howdy, Ben Smith.
I guess you're a cowboy, Jimmy pointed to the lariat.
I guess.
So's my dad. He owns a lot of cows. Got a great big ranch. I'm staying there all summer.
Sounds good. And healthy.
Yeah, I guess. I wonder...
What?
That rope?
This is a lasso, son, Ben smiled.
Well, could you lasso something with it?
What?
Anything.
Jimmy Deegan shrugged. Ben looked around. Effortlessly, he circled the lariat, threw, and looped it around the horns of the Chrysler about 15 feet away.
Neat! Jimmy exclaimed.
Just as effortlessly, Ben loosened the noose of the lariat and flipped it off the horns. As he started to draw it back, Jimmy's father approached and held out his hand. James Deegan looked like a man of the West, but only when he spent time in the West. Tall, athletic, impressive. But Deegan also spent time, just as much or even more time, on the East Coast, and was just as impressive and comfortable in a Savile Row suit and Homburg. A man of many successful enterprises, a man of all seasons and all regions.
Jim Deegan.
They shook.
Ben Smith.
Pretty handy with that lariat, Mr. Smith. Haven't seen you around here before. Deegan pointed at the pickup. Passing through?
No, Ben smiled. My passing days are over.
Looking for work, Mr. Smith? I could use some help. Own the Big Brawny Ranch.
That's a coincidence. So could I. Own the Little Brawny.
There was a slight pause.
Yeah, I guess you could. That place is somewhat out of shape.
Well, so am I. But I hope to do something about that. About the Little Brawny, I mean.
Good idea, now that I'm off the circuit.
Oh, the Ben Smith. Now I recognize you. You're the rodeo rider, aren't you?
Was.
Ben glanced at the young boy. Now, if I had me a son like that, he could... James Deegan's voice was flat. Jimmy has diabetes.
So does Duke Morton.
Who's Duke Morton?
Last year's all-round champion cowboy. No comment from Mr. Deegan, who turned and started to walk away. Then, over his shoulder,
"We better be getting along, Jimmy boy."
Jimmy's attention was still on Ben Smith.
"I'm learning to ride. Dad gave me a pony for my birthday."
"That's fine. You got the makings of a real wrangler.
But could you teach me how to lasso?"
"Jimmy!"
James Deegan's voice from a distance. "Better get going, son," Ben said. "Your mom will be waiting."
"Mom's not with us."
"Oh, I'm sorry."
"Well, she's not dead or anything. They're what they call separated. It's custody for the summer."
"Jimmy!"
The voice more imperative. Ben nodded toward Deegan, then looked at Jimmy. Jimmy turned and walked toward his father, but waved back to Ben.
So long.
Adios, cowboy. Ben lifted the lariat. The Chrysler turned onto the road and headed toward the Big Brawny. Ben moved to the pickup where Randy had just finished filling the gas tank.
15 cents a gallon, 10 gallons even. That'll be a green sheet and a half, sir.
Here's 2 green sheets. Keep the hard part.
Much obliged, mister. Ben. And I was wondering.
What?
Do you mind if I call Skinny Dugan over at the Beacon and tell him that Ben Smith's back to stay? He writes about you most every week. Keeps printing that same picture of you as the 3-time all-round champion.
You mean Skinny Dugan Jr.?
No, sir. The original. Only he's not as skinny anymore. Must tip 170 pounds.
The same Skinny Dugan who charged up San Juan Hill with Teddy Roosevelt.
The same. I'd appreciate it. So would he.
Well, you go ahead if you want to, but I was a mite thinner in that picture, too.
Thanks. And hell's fire. I hope I'm in as good a shape when I'm your age.
Thanks, I think. Ben smiled. The closer he drove toward the Little Brawny and away from the Dust Bowl, the more the land changed. What had been a barren behind was melding into fertile ground. The stripped brown land had given way to darker, richer soil and green grass that bent with the summer wind and still damp from the recent drizzle of rain and crowned with splashes of wildflowers scattered from the level valley platform upward along the rising flanks of the pitted hills. The land changed for the better, but the vision in his mind changed too. It was one thing to sit at the Appaloosa with aches, bruises, broken bones, and scars on his body, his expression and voice putting on a calm front, and announcing to close friends that he was quitting the life, times, and triumphs he had experienced most of his adult life, and was going home. It was altogether another to face the reality of doing just that. In the past, he had sometimes gone into a strange, new place and had the feeling that he'd seen it or been there before. But now he was doing the opposite, going to a place where he'd spent his youth among family and friends, and wondering what it would look and feel and actually be like. Yes, one door closes and another opens. But what lies behind that new door? After years of championships, cheering crowds, applause, prize money, adoration, and more money, the rodeos in small towns and big cities, from Globe, Lubbock, Hattiesburg, Pueblo, to Abilene, Wichita, Kansas City, Chicago, New York, and even Hollywood, where he met and made friends with some of the most famous people in movies and the world. But how much can the human body endure? How many aches, bruised, broken bones, and scars? He had known a battalion of rodeo riders who took one more ride and ended stove-up cowboys on Gower Gulch, or worse, much worse, on crutches, wheelchairs, pathetic and penniless in this decade of the Great Depression, with no home to go back to. Ben Smith had escaped from all that. He was going home to the Little Brawny. He was practically on the last mile. The song said, "The last mile's the hardest to find." Would it look familiar, or like a place he had never been to before? Was Ben Smith trying to call back the summers in vain?
Chapter 5. On the main street of the town of Sheridan, the sign on the window in broad, faded yellow letters read, "The Sheridan Beacon, published every Thursday. Skinny Dugan, publisher, editor, and scribbler." Inside, vintage everything. Roll-top desk, battered furniture, ceiling fan, Ben Franklin heating stove, printing press, and clutter of years of use and abuse. On the scarred walls, dusty framed portraits of Ulysses S. Grant, Theodore Roosevelt, and Franklin D. Roosevelt. At the roll top, on the candle phone, Skinny Dugan listened.
"Yeah, yeah. Well, I'll be a son of a horny toad." "Yeah. He was?
He did.
When?" "Well, hell yes. Anything else? You sure?"
"Damn well told.
Next edition, you bet. Sure, your this week's advertisement is no charge.
Skinny Dugan hung up, swiveled on his chair, and called out,
Tyrone!
Yes, Mr. Skinny, came the usual response.
How are you doing with tomorrow's edition?
All done.
Well, tear out the front page.
Skinny Dugan rose, strode up to his assistant.
Tyrone Roan, some said he looked like a scarecrow, only thinner. And there were those, kinder, who said he favored that character actor, Slim Somerville.
Tyrone had been Skinny Dugan's assistant since Woodrow Wilson was president.
Say again, Mr. Skinny?
We're reprinting the front page. Make it an extra.
Make what an extra?
The story. Exclusive.
Somebody shoot the president?
Hell no. This is the biggest story since Prohibition was repealed.
From one of our usuals?
For years, Skinny Dugan's three unpaid roving reporter staff consisted of Louis Martini, the barber, Clay Sykes, the postmaster, and young Randy Rollins.
Good old Randy. Looks like we're going to work all night.
We are?
Yes, we are.
Why this time?
'Cause somebody's come to town. And dig out that picture of Ben Smith.
Ben Smith was on his own land again. He had driven off a main road, onto a side road, then on what was little more than a dirt path toward the Little Brawny headquarters and subsidiary structures, small bunkhouse, corral, barn. Out of shape was an apt description. Headquarters in the early days was a two-story, 12-room timber dwelling with three stone fireplaces and wraparound porch. When the headquarters burned to the ground after the big war and Ben came back, he had replaced it with a cabin-like structure, then left ranching for another unpredictable profession, rodeo riding. Ben got out of the pickup's cab and out of habit took the lariat with him. He walked up the two steps onto the small porch, then turned around for another look at the remnants of a once vast, proud, and thriving enterprise. Was this now Ben Smith's last mile? He had expected to be met by someone named Alexander Brown, the old caretaker house-sitter who had lived here since Ben left. But Xander Brown was nowhere in sight. Ben had no key, but he walked to the front door, turned the knob, and the unlocked door creaked open. He went in, looked around. Ben Smith was home. He had been in better places, much better, but also in worse, much worse. He noticed a sheet of paper on the table. He sat at one of the Douglas chairs, put his hat and lariat on the table, and picked up the paper, which had been weighted down with a heavy cup. He smiled and read the uneven print on the page.
Dear my friend Mr. Ben, so sorry I had to leave earlier than we expected, but my younger sister by 6 years, Eliza, come all the way from Missoula to take me to the old folks' home, where she works, that I told you about, and she had some car trouble. She had to buy a used tire and spark plugs. Thanks to part of that $500 that you sent me as a bonus for the little work I've been able to do around here. I don't know what I would have done without what you've been paying me for doing practically nothing around here. I left the front door unlocked, since nobody's come around for a long time, anyhow. Mr. Ben, please turn this paper over to the other side. The electric is on, and the new telephone works for you. Excuse the poor printing and grammar, but you know I only got through the middle of the sixth grade, for I had to go to sharecropping with my daddy to help out the family. I tried to call you and tell you all this, but you had gone from Globe by then. God bless you and keep you for all your goodness all your life. Mr. Ben, you're the best man I ever met. My arthritis has really gotten worser to where I can hardly get around. Your truly, Xander Brown. P.S. There's some eats in the icebox, air tights on the shelf, and a can of coffee on the shelf. Ben took a pack of Lucky Strikes out of his shirt pocket, lifted and lighted a cigarette, and inhaled. During his rodeo years, he had received hundreds of what they called fan letters, but this was the first time his eyes were moist. Ben was not a heavy smoker. In fact, he was trying to quit. But not cold turkey. He had a plan. Put a pack of Lucky Strikes in your shirt pocket. Smoke nothing else. Let it get stale. Every once in a while, when the urge mounts, light one of the stale sticks. Inhale a few bitter puffs, and usually you'll want to snuff it out. Usually. But not this time. Instead, Ben rose and walked out of the open door to get a breath of fresh air along with the stale intake. He just got to the porch when he heard it and reacted to the sound. Faint at first, but not for long. It grew louder, the staccato beat of a distant drum. Then closer, louder, like 100 drums. He dropped the butt of the Lucky onto the porch, then squashed it with his boot, took another step to get a better view, a view he hadn't seen in too many years. They were all the colors of the West. Dun, sorrel, red, black, mouse gray, dappled, creamy palomino, and black stallion. Mustangs. Ben Smith watched, smiling. The thundering herd, wild-eyed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.